It is the participation that will show that you are really being trained. But if you are only observing it and assimilating it, and you never do it, you are not going to be well trained. Get involved in leading a house fellowship. Get involved in giving your testimony. Get involved in leading a prayer meeting. Get involved in the work of the Lord. It is that participation that eventually helps you to be well trained. Number 7, affirmation. Affirmation. As Paul the Apostle was sending Timothy somewhere, he affirmed him. He said, I'm sending Timothy to you. He's a fellow laborer. He's a minister of the gospel. He's our brother. And I know him. And he's going to give you the right thing. You affirmed them. Number 8. Continuation. When we learn something, what makes us not to be able to actually remember the things we had learned? Do you know why we learn something sometimes, and then about 2 weeks after or 3 weeks after, we don't even remember at all? Number 1, because of a weak impression. The time you are learning that thing, it had a weak impression on you. You are not writing any notes when you are hearing. You are just, hearing, and then you are dozing, and because of that weak impression, about 1 week later, you can't remember. Number 2, disuse. When you learn something, you don't put it into practice immediately. That disuse is going to lessen what you are getting from that thing. Number 3, interference. When you are learning something, then another thing comes to interfere with it, and then blocks the way that you are not able to remember those things anymore. That's the reason why there is a forgetfulness. That's the reason why you are not able to retain the things you have learned. Number 4, we call it repression. Repression. That is when something else comes, another event comes, another idea comes, that presses out that thing away from your life. How do you count all those things? So that you'll be able to have real continuation in your learning, and you'll have real continuation in your ability to assimilate. Number 1, strong impression. At the time you are following Paul the Apostle, you allow the life of Paul the Apostle to make a strong impression on you. The teaching coming from Paul the Apostle to make a strong impression on you, and you are jotting it down, and you are reading, and you are writing down the notes. Number 2, continuous practice. You learn it now, you go to practice it. You learn it now, you go to practice it. Anything you learn, any practical thing you learn, the moment you learn it, after the teacher has gone, after the leader has gone, you make a practice again, a practice again. That continuous practice, it was what will help you to actually have the retention of the thing you are learning. Number 3, uninterrupted involvement. Uninterrupted involvement. You are maybe in the house fellowship, you are in the Zoom, or you are among the leadership. You have just been brought into leadership, and you are supposed to attend the leaders' meeting every Tuesday, and you do not allow any interruption. You are involved every time. Anything going on, you are available. You are already there. Anything they want to do, you are available. You are already there. That is the thing that will help you to actually be well trained. Number 4, daily simple improvement. Just a little step at a time. But a little improvement at a time. That you are doing that thing today, the thing you learned last month, you have been doing it every week and every day, and then a little forward march, a little improvement every time. That is the thing that will help you to actually have the training that you ought to have, and before long, you'll be a qualified, effective, dynamic Timothy in Jesus' name. I come to point number 2, the process of preparing temples for church establishment. The process of preparing temples for church establishment. I'm going to show you something in the Word of God. When you study the Word of God very carefully, there's a revelation we have in the Word of God that shows the first thing to be done and then the second thing to be done. The first thing to be done, and then the second thing to be done. First, you build up the spiritual lives of members of the church. That's the very first thing. That's what always comes forth. And then, number 2, you have to build a sanctuary or temple where God's people can worship the Lord. First, you teach the Word of God. You build up the lives of the people. You build up the families of the people. You establish the doctrines of the Bible. And then, second, you have to follow up by building a temple for the sanctuary. And now we're talking about establishing the church. And building temples comes into establishing the church. Let me just show you examples in the Word of God. Let's go back to the Old Testament. In Exodus chapter 20, I'm reading from verse 1. In Exodus chapter 20 verse 1, do you understand that when Moses brought the children of Israel out of the wilderness, out of Egypt, and he came into the wilderness, God did not immediately say, build the sanctuary for me, build the temple for me. That's not number one. The number one, when you bring people out of sin, when you bring people out of Egypt, the number one thing is to teach them the word of God. Look at Exodus chapter 20 verse 1, and God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, which hath brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children, unto the third and the fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. For the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day, to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, and nor thy son, nor daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gate. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth and the sea and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is thy neighbor's. What is the Lord doing here? The Lord is building up the moral lives of the people. The very first thing when you come out of sin is to be taught the word of God. And you will understand that is the method that the Lord has led us through, following the Bible. This is a Bible church. When the people came, they came out of the world. We taught them doctrine and taught them the word of God, practical life of the believer. But do you know, after teaching them the word of God, after teaching the morals, then the Lord, now chapter 25 of Exodus. Exodus chapter 25. Here the Lord now said, the time has come, you need to build a sanctuary for me. In Exodus chapter 25, it says, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, that they bring me an offering. And every man that giveth it willingly with his heart, ye shall take my offering. And this is the offering which ye shall take of them: gold and silver and brass and blue and purple and scarlet and fine linen and goat's hair and ram skins dyed red and badger skin and sheeting wood, oil for the light, spices for anointing oil, and for the sweet incense, onyx stones and stones to be set in the ephod and in the breastplate, and let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. Let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. Do you see what we are saying? Number one, we build the lives of the people for the teaching of the word of God. And then after that, we have to build a sanctuary. You know, if people don't understand, they'll say, why is the church now concentrating on building? Why is the church now talking about building a temple and building this and building that? Are we not known for just doctrine? And that's number one. Number one doesn't mean that that's the totality of the thing. When the Lord brought them out, the very first thing is to teach them the word of God. After teaching them the word of God, then comes the necessity of building a sanctuary where we can worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Let me show you this in 1 Chronicles chapter 28. 1 Chronicles chapter 28. Again, you are going to see there's number one, and then there's number two that must follow. In 1 Chronicles chapter 28, I'm reading from verse 9. And thou Solomon, my son, know thou the God of thy father, and serving with a perfect heart and with a willing mind. For the Lord searcheth all hearts and understandeth all the imaginations of the thought. If thou seek him, he'll be found of thee. But if thou forsake him, he will cast thee off forever. Take it now. For the Lord has chosen thee to build a house for the sanctuary. Be strong and do it. You see in verse 8, first of all, Solomon, let's take care of your mouth, of your moral life, of the moral principles, of righteousness, of holiness, of purity. After you have established that holiness and purity, then you take it now, because the Lord has chosen you to build a sanctuary for him. Let's look at chapter 29. As the God said that message, chapter 29, I'm reading from verse 6. Then the chief of the fathers and the princes of the tribes of Israel and the captains of the thousands and of hundreds with the rulers of the king's work offered willingly and gave for the service of the house of God gold 5,000 talents and 10,000 drams and of silver 10,000 talents and of the brass 18,000 talents and 100,000 talents of iron. Now do you see, as they were building the sanctuary, they began to count in thousands. They needed thousands of this and thousands of this and thousands of that. And all the people were involved. But you understand, first of all, the teaching of the Word of God. The emphasis on the doctrines of the Bible. The emphasis on holiness and the emphasis on the moral lives of the people. After that, the sanctuary. First, the salvation for the people. First, the sanctification. And after that you have the sanctuary, the building of the temple, the building of the house of God that will befit the salvation, the sanctification, the purity and the holiness that you are talking about, so that the people will be able to worship God in spirit and in truth. I'm reading on to verse 8 of that chapter 29. And they with whom precious stones were found, gave them to the treasure of the house of the Lord by the hand of Jehiel and the Gershonite. That then the people rejoiced, for that they offered willingly, because with perfect heart they offered willingly to the Lord. And David the king also rejoiced with good joy. That means then, as we're talking about building the headquarters church, that means we're going to offer willingly. And nobody is going to be sitting back in a corner somewhere saying, it looks like we're abandoning doctrine. We're abandoning, you know, what we are known for, holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. No, we're not abandoning anything. We're just following the Bible and following the Word of God. First of all, establish the doctrine. First of all, establish the holiness of life. And then after that, the Lord calls us that will build a befitting temple, a befitting sanctuary that will glorify his name. Let's look at Ezra chapter 7. You know, for many people, what many people know about Ezra is that he was a teacher of the Word of God. Yes, but there is more. And what they have done is that they only read the first part, and the first part is always the holiness. It's always the study of the Word. It's always the teaching of the Word of God. Ezra chapter 7, I'm reading from verse 10. In Ezra chapter 7, verse 10. For Ezra had prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord, and to do it, and to teach in Israel statutes and judgments. That's the first thing. That must always be a priority. That must always be number one. But that number one is not the end. Let's look at that same chapter. We're looking at verse 16. And all the silver and gold that thou canst find in all the province of Babylon, with the free will offering of the people and of the priests, offering willingly for the house, for the house, for the house of their God, that the which is in Jerusalem. And you'll see that in verse 10, the first thing to do is to study the Word of God. The first thing to do is to teach the Word of God. The first thing to do is to obey the Word of God. And then after that, obedience. And after teaching the Word of God, after explaining to the people, this is doctrine, this is purity, this is holiness, this is righteousness, then you move on to the second phase, which is the building. In fact, you need to look at verse 18. In verse 18, and whatsoever shall seem good to thee and to thy brethren, do what the rest of the silver and the gold that do after the will of your God. That is, the offering was even so much that the king was telling them, after you have finished building the house of God, if the money remains, that means you can use that as the Lord will direct you. In verse 20, It says, and whatsoever more shall be needful for the house of thy God, which thou shalt have occasion to bestow. Bestow it out of the king's treasure house. As the poor people gave, the king also gave. As the ordinary people gave, the highly placed people, they also gave. As the poor people are giving. Even the jobless people, they're saying, what can I do? Am I going to allow that headquarters building to be finished without my having anything there, a penny there? I'm going to do something. Then that's the reason why our leaders will be talking to us, our overseers will be talking to us, and they will be telling us, this is the minimum amount that everybody is expected to give. In fact, I'm believing that our parents will not allow their children to just come empty-handed and not contribute anything to the building of the church. Although your leader might tell you, the young people, they are excused, the youth, they are excused, and the children, they are excused. Our leaders may say that, but you parents, you are not going to allow your children to be excused from having a part in contributing and building to that headquarters wall. Is going to be done. I said it's going to be done. All of us who are here, adults, who did they say jobless? It is no jobless person in the house of God. If you are jobless, the Lord will provide jobs for you in Jesus' name. And even our children, don't we give offering to our children? When you get to church, my boy, when you get to church, my daughter, this is what we are going to offer in the offering. Those children are not working, but you still give them something. Don't go empty-handed to the church. And then to our youth, secondary school children, or those who are passed out of school, our parents, you'll give them their own. You'll say, this is what you have to contribute. Every member of my family, every member of the church will give something in building this church. And when we finish building it, you will rejoice that you had a part in the building of that church. You'll have a part in it. I said you'll have a part in it. You know, our leaders might be telling you some small amounts. For example, if a leader comes up and he says, well, if you can just give 2,000 naira a month, like,